Hey, I'm Michael, and this is Michael in the Middle. It's an intergenerational relational podcast for people who are interested in better human interaction. I'm glad you're here. Hey, friends, Michael in the Middle is back. Had to take a little time off during January with a lot of different things that were going on. And I was trying to find just the right person to be the guest on Michael in the Middle episode number 50. And I'm pretty sure I found him in the person of Joe Drake. That's Joe on the other side. Hey, buddy.
Hey, man. How you doing? Good to be with you.
I am so good. Well, I'm not good. God is good, but God has been good to me. And amen. So I'm feeling good today. It's a beautiful day outside in Nashville, Tennessee. And I hope you're going to get out and get on that bike of yours if you haven't already with weather like this, you know?
Man, I left the bike because I was hauling a bunch of stuff in the truck today, and it's almost 70 degrees out there. And as soon as I'm done with this, I've got church board meeting tonight. Can everybody say yay?
Well, at least you dressed the part. And as we go along through this conversation over the next little bit, folks will be able to see you on a motorcycle and beside a motorcycle and with motorcycle friends from all over the place and literally with motorcycling around the world, clear on the other side. We'll get to that in just a little bit. But as we always do on Michael in the Middle, when we have guests, the point is that kind of want to maybe just say, tell me a little bit of your story, Joe, and how you got in the middle of what you're doing now. I'll ask some follow-up questions, but how'd you get your start in this life? Where were you born?
Wow, I was born in Tacoma, Washington. I was raised in Oklahoma, started out in the small town of Ripley, Oklahoma, and then moved to Oklahoma City when my mom went to work for Tinker Air Force Base as an Air Force mechanic. Wow. Grew up in Assembly of God Church. And my mom actually worked double shifts as a B-52 aircraft mechanic to provide an education for my brother and I to go to Christian school in the church we grew up in. So I remember that easily as my mom doing that. She finally got married again to my stepdad, who I call my dad. He was a two-tier Vietnam vet. And so a lot of stuff came along with that we may hit on in a little while, but grew up in church, started running from God and started even guys in the church that I ran around with. We all started hitting the streets hard. So I ended up an addict and alcoholic, and life brought us to Nashville, Tennessee as a drywall contractor, actually, after Val and I got married. Val and I were married on April the 4th, 1987, and May the 20th, we were in Nashville, Tennessee. So we have spent our entire married life right here.
That's awesome. We gotta back up just a minute.
Okay.
Your mom worked on B-52s?
Yeah, my mom was a B-52 aircraft mechanic at Tinker Air Force Base for, she retired 31 years as a B-52 aircraft mechanic.
Goodness. Well, you know, I mean, I know you know that I was born and raised in Oklahoma, and from the time I was 5 till I was 15, we lived in Oklahoma City. But I've always known about Tinker Air Force Base. It's one of the really key bases in all of the you know U.S. Air Force installations around the globe, really. But Tinker played a key role in that, and I find out things about your mom every now and then. And we've got a, I want to save a picture that I have of you and your mom at Bethel Church for a little later on when we get to that part of the story. But amazing lady. That is so cool. So did Nashville just pop up as a place you thought you might want to land? Did Val have some friends out here? What got you to Nashville?
Lord, no, Val had no friends out here. In fact, we found ourselves every other weekend, I had to drive her back to Oklahoma City to go see friends. She was absolutely miserable. Drywall, actually. The industry kind of crashed in Oklahoma City when bank started falling due to oil loans and stuff. And so the company I used to work for started calling me and asking me to come to Nashville and help them tape and finish houses. So they finally got the money right. And I came out. Our honeymoon was actually coming here. I worked while Val looked for some place for us to live. And we ended up first over in Antioch, Tennessee. And we moved around every year. We moved. I was an expert at moving, man. We could load it up and be gone in a day's time and unpacked and ready for life again in another day's time. So,
yeah. Hey, baby, I know you always dreamed of a vacation to the beach, but how about going with me to drywall some houses? How's that sound?
Yeah. And that she took it. It was just absolutely amazing. Yeah. So, she absolutely hated it. We both played softball and we had a lot of folks that we played softball with back in Oklahoma. And she missed softball. So we would go home for tournaments. We'd go home for anything she wanted to do to go back and do that.
Yeah. Valerie's a saint.
Yes, she is.
We'll get some more of that story as it unfolds. So when did you start riding motorcycles?
So I grew up riding motorcycles. I got motorcycles at a young age. Mom and dad wouldn't buy them for us. So we cut grass and saved up and started riding motorcycles. My first one was a little Yamaha 60. Then as I got older, I started riding a KZ 650. I had a KZ 750 and a KZ 900 in Oklahoma, just raising Cane. That was the crotch rockets back then. And then, gave them up for quite a few years until I got saved and, actually God started calling me into biker ministries. And then I got my first Harley Davidson motorcycle. So, told my wife, I said, "Hey, I found a Harley, and it's cool." And, my wife was, Val said, "You hadn't bought it yet?" I got the coolest wife in the world, man. I got the coolest wife in the world. So 23 years later, I'm a national elder in Bikers for Christ Motorcycle Ministry and still riding bikes and having fun.
So you talked about a Yamaha 60. That's kind of almost a miniature motorcycle, right?
Yeah,
am I remembering that?
Yeah, that's right.
If you go to Corey's Hot Dogs in Mount Juliet, out in Providence, I think he's got one of those little bikes in there. Cause I was craving a Chicago dog yesterday. And I went out there to get something to eat and I looked down there and I saw, man, that looks like some of those little dirt bikes that my friends in Oklahoma had. The closest I came to it. And I'll try to drop a picture in this. Cause I was never a motorcycle dude, Joe, but when I was 11 years old, my parents got me a Honda Mini Trail 50. And it was a mini bike, but it was a Honda. It was a good little running bike. And then a couple of my friends had those either Yamaha 60s or I think Honda had an SL80, if I remember correctly. And so they were in between a mini bike and a full size motorcycle. But
right.
that Yamaha 60, I remember that bike too, because growing up in Oklahoma, several of my buddies and the church that my dad was pastoring at the time had a nice big hill behind it. And guys would come over there and we'd ride around through and occasionally sneak off into the neighborhood. I was never courageous enough to be quite as wild as you got there for a little while.
Yeah. My dad, when we started getting motorcycles, my dad knew what my brother and I were going to do. They worked all day long and we were home during the summer. And so he came home from work one day and he goes out to his shed in the backyard and comes back in and he said, "Y'all been on that motorcycle today?" "No, sir, we sure hadn't." "Nope, we sure haven't." "Come on out to the shed with me, boys." And we went out to the shed and my dad rolls the motorcycle out and he points at the clear packing tape on the back tire that is shredded. We had been riding that thing from the time they left.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
He beat us up one side of the yard and down the other. So yeah, we were mischievous. So
yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. you moved to Nashville with Val and at that point, do you feel like you were still running from what God had in mind for your life?
Oh, I know I was. I had grown up with so much what I refer to as church hurt. The church that I grew up in, mom was, and we were just kind of considered white trash. Because mom wasn't married, she was divorced, and then when she remarried, the church wouldn't even marry her and my dad.
Wow.
So I always had this animosity towards the church, and I always thought that the church will never want me. And so now I was on the run from God, and as the story goes on, even when Val was pregnant the first time, we lost twins about 6 months. Yeah, about 6 months into the pregnancy. And boy, that was the fuel that I just shook my fist at God and said, I don't need you. You stay on your side of the universe. I'll stay on mine. If this is who you are, if that's a loving God, I don't want anything to do with you.
Wow.
And I destroyed everything in my house that had anything to do with Bibles, crosses, anything to do with religion. I destroyed and threw every bit of it out.
It was a few years later that this picture that I'm going to ask Rob Walls, my producer, to put up. But this is a picture of you and your mom. We'll fill in some of the blanks between here and there. But this, I want the folks to see a picture, if they're able to watch, of you and your mom standing there in the sanctuary at Bethel Church of the Nazarene out on the north side of town. That's you and your mom standing there together. But there's a great story that I know, and I want you to tell the folks about it. When you finally found yourself in a place where you could trust God again with all the things, well, just period, all the things, you know, yeah. I mean, I can't imagine the pain. My wife and I didn't ever have to deal with loss, but we've had that in our family, with one of our sons and his wife, and we know a little bit about what that's like to lose a child that you, or in your case, to lose twins. That's just unbearable. But your mom, if she could work on B-52s, you know, she's a tough woman, and she never gave up on you, did she? In a sense, even though the church that y'all were growing up in didn't treat her right, she didn't turn her back on God as a result, right? Tell me that story. You know where
I'm going. Yeah, mom kept us in the church, and I graduated from the school that we grew up in. The church that I grew up in had a private Christian school, and my mom made sure we were there every time the doors were open. But now mom prayed for me, even in those times that I would be coming home from jail or from fights or out of the bars and stuff. I could walk into the house and I would see into my mom and dad's room, and whether it was 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning, there's a little small light on and my mom was on her knees praying. When I walked in the door, she would get up and just turn the light off and get back in bed. She may have had to be up in two more hours to go to work. Val and I were literally on the verge of divorce. I was full-blown alcoholic and addict. I was drinking. At the end of my addiction, I was drinking a case to two cases of beer every day, usually a fifth of Jack Daniels, and going through an eight ball of cocaine, which is 3.5 grams every day to 3 days, spending $500 to $1,000 a day in my addictions. And Val never knew it. So we were on the verge of divorce. We were at a point where we hated each other. We just coexisted, and was getting ready for divorce. And Val came in and said, we're going to give church a try. If this doesn't work, then we're done. So I knew a builder that I worked for was a Nazarene pastor in Mount Juliet, Tennessee, Dwight Southworth. And his son Todd and I used to party together. Todd invited me out to play golf and tried to talk to me about Jesus. And I just told him, you keep that to yourself. I don't need it. So finally, we just decided to go. And we went to Covenant Fellowship. And we walked in the doors. And that Sunday, man, this churning in my gut, my head was going crazy. And I knew that God was calling me. But I walked out those doors that day without accepting him. that Monday night, Todd and his wife, Betty, and their two kids showed up at our house with a paper bag with homemade chocolate chip cookies in it. And they just simply said to us, we wanted to say that we were glad you came to church today. And of course, I knew them, so we invited them in. And as I was sitting on the arm of that sofa and we were talking, I heard this voice say, Joe, accept me now, or you'll die never knowing me. So I told Todd that if I died tonight, that night I would go to hell. And Todd started crying and he said, I'm not leaving here without giving you a chance to ask Jesus into your life. So we went up into my man cave, into my bonus room upstairs, and I asked Jesus into my life. The next Sunday, my wife went to the altar, Val went to the altar and asked Jesus into her life. But that night I got saved, I called my mom and I said, Mom, I asked Jesus back into my life. And of course, she started crying, started celebrating.
Yeah.
And I said, Mom, I don't have a Bible one in the house. Will you send me one? So about 3 days later, this monster cardboard box shows up at my house and it is full of Bibles. Every translation you could think of, from King James to New Living Translation, the Living Word, it had them all in there. And I found a Bible in there that my brother and I had bought my mom for Mother's Day 1 year. And as I started glancing through it, I kept finding these little scrap pieces of paper that looked like they had gone through a washing machine. And so I called my mom and I said, Mom, I got the Bibles. I said, I kept finding these little scrap pieces of paper with scripture written down on them. These look important. Do you want them back? And I'm going to cry. My mom said, no, son, you keep those. All those years you were away from the Lord, I continued to pray for you. And every time God gave me scripture, I wrote it down and I put it in my shoes and I went to work, B-52 aircraft mechanic. And I stood on the word that one day you would come back to relationship with Jesus. Here I am today. Yeah. A pastor.
My dad was a preacher. And I know you remember my folks real well.
Very well.
My dad, in the old days when we had hymnals in church, we would turn to, I can't remember the number of it, of the song, but turn to page so-and-so and we'll sing standing on the promises of Christ, my King.
Yeah.
Through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory to the highest. I will shout and sing standing on the promises of God. Yeah. That story has moved me and it's like I was hearing it for the first time again today. And I hope you folks that are listening now can understand the power of that. My dad used to say, I'd rather be found standing on the promises than sitting on the premises.
Amen. Amen.
That's great. You know, which is something that leads me, you know, to move on. Man, we could probably do a movie on your life. It's had a lot of twists and turns. But I want to ask you some questions that may seem disjointed. I mean, one of the things that I just marvel at is how a lady like your mom, who, you know, she's not what you'd call a big and sturdy frame, but boy, she must have had an incredible amount of strength, both physically and emotionally, to walk through all of that with you. What did her example say to you and your brother about never giving up?
Wow. Yeah. Mom was just fierce. She still is, and tenacious. And, I had asthma growing up and played sports and all that stuff. And Mom never let me settle. Son, this isn't a handicap. This isn't something that keeps you from doing things. You can do anything you set your mind to. Sometimes you just have to work a little harder to do it.
Wow.
My mom had calluses on her hands that I haven't met a man yet that had calluses like my mom had. I haven't. Even some farmers. I'm like, yeah, no, you ain't there. So she was just, she knew that how she needed to raise us because of the example of her mom and dad, my grandma and grandpa King. And she knew that with everything in her, she was going to give us every opportunity to have a relationship with Jesus, whether the church accepted us or not. She was going to make sure that we were at absolutely everything and involved in everything. And she did that tenacity and that resiliency to see her boys come to relationship with Jesus. It's unmatched, man. It's unmatched.
Yeah. Yeah. I just love that. Yeah. I just love that. Hey, so you rode for a while in Oklahoma, got pretty wild, got pretty messed up. Were you riding on the regular when you got out here to Nashville? I mean, did you have a motorcycle and all of that?
No, I didn't. I'd actually got rid of all the motorcycles and the dirt bikes, and it was years. It was probably, well, let's see, I've been doing this for 23 years. It was probably 25 years ago that I finally started riding again, and I just turned 60, so you can do the math on that. But no, there was a lot of years that I just wasn't riding. I just didn't feel like I was supposed to be doing that. But yeah,
and it was after you came back to the Lord that you started riding again.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, I wasn't riding.
Hey, have you ever thought about the holy irony of that when you're out? Yeah. You know, literally. Steppenwolfing it, you know, Born to Be Wild. I think they did I know they did Magic Carpet Ride, but yeah. Who did Born to Be Wild? Do you remember?
I don't even remember who the artist was, but I can pull
it up. I mean, we all know the song, Get Your Motor Running, Head Out on the Highway. You know, you're doing that kind of stuff out in Oklahoma, and you're wild as a buck and all those kinds of things. You moved to Nashville and you're still trying to sort it out. But you obviously loved riding as a younger man, and that part of your life just either went away or was taken away for a little while. But it's almost like, you know, when you came back to the Lord, it just made sense to get back on a bike, because that was one of the ways that the Lord was going to use you to impact other people with your story.
Yeah, I actually, I brought a young man out of prison, and I had to go to Fort Wayne, Indiana to get him. His dad was an evangelist in the Church of the Nazarene, and he had a motorcycle. In fact, my first Harley was his. And so I ended up taking that bike and bought him a vehicle, and he had been in motorcycle clubs. He had run with some hardcore clubs. So we actually started a motorcycle ministry called the Unchained Gang out in Mount Juliet. And man, we made up patches. We did all kinds of stuff and got everything together. We spent thousands putting this motorcycle ministry together, only to find out that the clubs here in Tennessee, they wouldn't accept us. They're like, well, number one, you got gang in there. We're not a gang. We're motorcycle clubs. Number two, you've got red and white. This is a black and white state. They just came down and just kept listing things. And we thought, well, okay, you'll never get in the clubhouse. You'll never get into any of this. But God put another man in our life and brought us over to Bikers for Christ Motorcycle Ministry. And man, I've been doing that for 23 years now, and working.
How many people would you say are involved with BFC?
Oh, we're international, so in all the states, and I think in about 20 or 24 countries. But membership now is just around 2,000 throughout, amazing. And it is mainly the hardcore motorcycle clubs: Outlaws, Hell's Angels, Banditos, Pagans, Mongols, Warlocks. It's all over the place. So I serve on a national level now instead of a regional level. Churches kind of want you to be at on services on Sundays now, so I don't get to travel as much as I used to.
In the middle of all of that, the Mount Juliet experience and the great way that the Lord used the Southworths to impact your life in such a great way, you ended up finding yourself over here at the campus church at Trevecca Community Church. Who got y'all over there?
You know what? Actually, one of our friends that had attended out in Mount Juliet, they got plugged in at TCC when Dwight Gunner came on board at TCC. And they invited Devin, our daughter, to come to a youth event over there. And you got to understand, Devin was really tall, So she was taller than most all the boys in her class.
Yeah.
She was being picked on. She was in junior high and she was being picked on. We found out years later that Devin had even contemplated suicide. Devin came home from that event that night and said, and just with a glow on her face, and said, "Mom, Dad, the girls were fighting over who was going to sit next to me tonight." And that was the youth group at TCC. And so I wanted to know, I had heard about, you know, Trevecca Community at one time was considered, was called College Hill.
Right.
And some folks referred to it as College Chill. So,
right.
And I had heard that through the grapevine. So, sure. I just told Val, I said, I want to see what the heartbeat of this church is. So Val and I got the old 75 American Captain America red, white, and blue motorcycle out. We walked in the doors the first Sunday. I had holy jeans on. I had flame boots on. You probably remember this.
I do.
Sleeveless t-shirt, a nasty Bikers for Christ cut that just stunk to high heaven. And I think I had on an American flag do-rag. And we pulled up at the front doors. And Dwight and the church body just absolutely loved us into relationship. And that's where we landed at. I think we were there for 12 or 14 years before God called us here to Bethel. So
that's where you and Val and Sarah and I met, obviously. And
yeah,
we don't have time to go into all those relationships, but one of my favorite pictures ever was when we had a district assembly over in Memphis. And I had on my nice suit. I was presenting the statues to newly ordained ministers, and you had one of your club hats on, and
missing right here.
And I grabbed that hat and put it on with my suit, and we're standing there, you know, all smiles. You brought a lot of smiles to people's faces, literally. Wow. across the U.S. And you've had a chance to travel abroad a time or two, haven't you?
I have, yeah, to Africa. I think I've done 5 trips to Africa, 4 of them working with Tim and Michelle Eby in West Africa. So yeah.
You are a fascinating man to me, Joe, for a lot of reasons. But the Lord really began to lead in your life to not only minister through, you know, something like Bikers for Christ, which is out there on the edge a little bit for some folks, but you know, you're now Reverend Joe Drake. You're pastor in a church. You get up and stand behind a pulpit in a stained glass window sanctuary. Yeah. You know, how can this be? Yeah.
I asked the same questions. I mean, it was one of those things that I thought, Lord, how are you going to use me here? This is a church with an incredible legacy, an incredible heritage, an incredible image in the Church of the Nazarene. Me? Really? So when we were installed, of course, that day there were bikers, there were recovery folks, there were outlaws in the service. There were all kinds of folks. And I still continued to ask that question. What am I doing here? How am I going to do? I have no idea what you want me to do. A month almost to the day after I was installed here as the pastor, Welcome Home Ministries moved into the 6,000 square foot house across the street and put 12 men in recovery in over there. And I broke down and I said, okay, God, now I know what you're up to. And so we get opportunity to work with 14 recovery houses every single week. I get to be a part of the lives of men and women, over 100 men and women every week. Getting to share the hope of Jesus Christ. We're inviting these guys into relationship here. They're greeting at our front doors. They're doing prayers. They're participating in services. And we're getting an opportunity to see lives changed. And it has turned this church around because they're seeing lives being transformed, just like mine was.
How'd you and Val know Steve and Pamela Sands?
Well, Steve was part of New Attitudes Motorcycle Club, and Steve and I actually met. I was doing a meeting called Let's Talk at their clubhouse, and Steve was a member. And Steve swore up and down he'd come in and eat dinner with us, but he would not stay for the meetings. When that Bible comes out, I'm leaving. And he did. And Steve has told me the story, and it scared me to death whenever he said it. He said, I watched you for 2 years. How can this guy with tattoos and this cut on that says Bikers for Christ on it, how can he be a Christian? He's got a knife on his hip. How can he be a Christian? And Steve watched, and he finally started sticking around for the meetings. And then one night, I had posed a question, and Steve thought, I got him. I'm going to shut him down right here, and I'm going to shut this whole God thing down. And before Steve could get anything out of his mouth, he broke down crying. He pulled me into a back room, into their club room, and he said, God's calling me to something. And I don't know what it is, and I'm scared to death. I feel like I'm standing on a diving board, and God's telling me to dive in. And I'm afraid he won't rescue me, and he won't be there. What do I do? And I said, Steve, jump in. Jump in, buddy. We'll be right there with you, and God will be right there with you. We'll do this together. So Steve prayed the sinner's prayer in the clubhouse that night. He didn't want anything to do with church. He had had it with religion. He grew up Catholic, and that's a story for another time. But we started inviting Steve to events at TCC, plays and dinners and concerts, and they came. Then we invited him to come to church with us and come to Sunday school with us. And the first class we walked him into was Dr. Tim Green's class. And Steve and Pam walked out of there. I mean, everything Tim said just went right over their heads.
That's not hard for any of us, you know.
Yeah, but he and they just said, yeah, that's not going to work. Well, one of the things that God had challenged Val and I to do was to go around and visit all the adult Sunday school classes and just spend some time in there and figure out how those church classes were made up and what they look like. And so we said, okay, let's try another one next week. So we took him into one of the other Sunday school classes. Steve and Pam have joined the church. I baptized Steve at the church at TCC. Steve is doing recovery ministries over there now. And Steve and Pam are still a part of the same Sunday school class that we walked him into, gosh, 10 years ago, 10, 12 years ago. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, he went from not wanting to be anywhere near the Bible to being a pastor at that church.
Yeah.
You know, he's one of the staff pastors, and you know, he and Pamela are they're just awesome people. I think the reason I wanted to lift them out in particular is because here's the thing. It's not just in the religious realm. It's just in the realm of humanity. Just being yourself and loving people opens a doorway to relationship with each other. And obviously, as you've talked about it here, to a relationship with God. And Joe, you and I have talked about this before many times. The world is full of sermons.
Yeah.
The world is full of platforms, but the world isn't always full of loving relationships. And the way I think the world, at least in my view, sees the most transformative change is when people have the opportunity, like Steve did with you for years, just to watch. And that's where the capacity for true life transformation can come. There are a lot of people who are sick of living like they're living, but they're just not sure there is a better way to live. And so they just keep living that way. Your life is a testimony to the power of God's grace at work through a little lady who will stand on the promises of God while she's working on a B-52.
Yeah.
And I mean, I bet you don't know how many people whose lives you've been able to touch and help with over the years. And praise the Lord for that, you know?
Yeah. It's, you know, I developed a long time ago, and I heard it the first time in Young Life. My wife and I, Val and I, were Young Life leaders for years. And I just kind of coined a phrase, don't ruin them with religion, spoil them with relationship.
Yeah.
And God has called us into relationships with those who are hurting and those who are lost.
Yeah.
He never meant for our churches to be a country club. It's a Holy Ghost hospital. And that's what Steve and Pam experienced walking into TCC. Steve was absolutely blown away that months later, after Dwight had already met them, that they came to church service and Dwight met them and entered and actually said their names.
Yeah.
And that's the heartbeat of TCC. And I love that church. If I weren't here, I would still be right there. Well, with Pastor Sean, and I'd be there today.
I think any place can be that kind of place.
Yeah.
If the people who are in that place are those kind of people. And you know, a lot of my podcasts have spiritual overtones. I don't know any of them that have turned into maybe a church service quite like this one has. But I no joke, folks who are listening and watching, I would issue you an invitation to think about what can happen to a person like Joe Drake or Val, you know, when they find relationships with people that are genuine and they understand that God really does care. Over my shoulder here, it's the mantra of my life: love God and love people. And you know, we may see things that we wish were different in people's lives, but we're probably not going to be the ones who are going to be able to bring about that change. You know, it's going to be when they open themselves up to allow God to do the work. And man, I could talk for hours to you.
Yeah.
I know you and I both got to go. Tell the folks real quickly, Val, what is it that Val does?
Val works for HCA Parallon. She actually just started working for Home. So she does back office work and does insurance claims from the hospitals and sends that on. I want to leave it with one last thing for those that may have families and loved ones who are struggling with addictions, who have walked away from God. My mom began to pray a prayer. God, put somebody in his path that will speak truth into his life and that he will see that you are real and that he will see that you love him unconditionally. And that's exactly what happened at Covenant Fellowship, Keith and Patty Showalter. They taught us how to love God and love people. My mom taught me how to love God and love people and do anything for him. And we just keep carrying that on. So that's what we're doing today. So
I love it.
Just pray, God, put somebody in my loved one's path that will bring them to that relationship. And I redneck double dog dare you to write scriptures down and put them in your shoes and stand on the word that loved one will come back to relationship. I'm living proof of that. I'm living proof of it today.
Love it. That is so wonderful. You recently went to Belfast, Ireland, right? To drop off that big, beautiful tall girl, Devin, that you talked about in the youth group. She's now studying abroad, as it were, in Ireland. What's she doing over there?
She is in Belfast, Ireland. She is pursuing her master's program and possibly her doctorate at Queen's University in Belfast, Ireland, on conflict resolution and social justice. So, yeah, I think she's taking conflict resolution so she can deal with me, Michael.
from Tacoma, Washington, to Oklahoma City, to Nashville, to literally points all over the globe, that this Drake odyssey continues. And I can't wait to see where it goes. Maybe we'll have to get you back on. Maybe I'll figure out a way to film a segment with you and Steve and Malcolm Alt and some of these guys that I don't even know if Malcolm rides anymore. He had to get those knees replaced and everything. But I'm fascinated with that whole side of things. We don't have time to get into all of that side of it. But I wanted people to hear your story, and I wanted people to know that when you get out there in the middle of doing something good for somebody else, it really does make a difference, doesn't it, Joe?
It does. We get an opportunity to let the brokenhearted know that you matter, you have value, and you have worth. And we take that message to the Nashville Rescue Mission, and we take that message to clubhouses and to Room in the Inn and to anywhere in the streets and to homeless camps. People matter. They have value and they have worth. It doesn't matter what they look like. They do. They matter.
I'll, I'll never be as cool as you, Joe, but I sure do love you.
You're way cooler than I am, Michael. You're way cooler than I am. I just wish I could dress like you do, buddy.
Hey, thanks for tuning in here to Michael in the Middle. It's great to be back. And I know you'll agree with me that we sure had a good one for number 50. And we'll see you next time. Thanks for being here.